Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bruno Jean-Etienne. I'm an in-house lawyer with a company called Trane Technology, and I'm also the ACC Belgium co-representative. Thank you for joining this morning for this interesting seminar on conductive affecting internal investigation. And we've seen that there is a lot of people that were willing to participate because it's effectively, prior to the pandemic, it was already a topic, but I would say within all the new conditions imposed by the COVID pandemic, it's even a much more interesting topic. Next slide. First of all, I'll provide you some quick information about ACC. So ACC stands for Association of Corporate Counsel. So it's a global association of corporate counsel with close to 47,000 members in the world. And the aim is really to help the corporate counsel to develop themselves within their role and to get some training. And this is what we are providing to you today. And there is also a lot of resources that are available on the web. Next slide. And as I was telling you, we are basically ACC Europe. We are a chapter of the global organization, which is based in the US. And over the region, we have 3,100 members. And for the Benelux region, we have close to 494 members. And the aim is really to develop those type of trainings. And also we have some 20 active practice groups where you can also focus on field of law that are of interest for your own in-house resource. Then some few practical tips. The presentation can be downloaded on your screen under the so-called name handout. Participant, for our Belgian participant, if you have filled your IBG number on the registration for the conference, you will be able to get some hourly credit for the ongoing training activity of IBG. And please feel free to use the chat. There is a question box, a chat function where you can fill up some question. We will try to answer them over the presentation, or whatever happened, you will get an answer to your question after the presentation. So with no ado, I'm going to give the floor to the team of Lydian, which is a Belgium international law firm, which are co-hosting with me this seminar and I'll give you the floor to Yann and Yves. Enjoy the seminar and stay tuned.
Thank you very much, Bruno, for this introduction. Good morning also on my behalf. We are both myself and Yves Lenders, lawyers from Lydian, the Belgian law firm. I'm specializing in employment law. So I'm an HR lawyer and looking at the topic of today from that perspective. And Yves is a litigator handling commercial and criminal litigation. And he's dealing with a topic from that perspective. Let me just start by setting out what we are planning to discuss today by way of an agenda. We have selected for you four, let's say, key questions, which we will try to answer or discuss during this webinar. We have a time slot of 1 hour and we have an international public, so we'll try to handle the topics as practical as possible and also a little bit high level. And not to go into too much detail of purely Belgian local legislation. You see the four questions on the slide. We will start with the question, when do you start the investigation? Second question is how you get the ball rolling. The third question on the agenda is how then effectively conduct the investigations? What actions and tools will you use in that context? And finally, when the investigation is done, what will you do with the outcome of the investigation? What are the next steps? But let us go move to the next slide, please. And before answering the first question, maybe giving you a bit of a general comment on the legal framework relating to internal investigations. In Belgium, as in most European countries, there is no, let's say, specific framework, legal framework for international investigations. The rules governing the investigation are based on pieces of law of different kind. Most important of all, and at first place, you have, of course, privacy issues. We will come back to that later on in the presentation. but Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which guarantees the privacy to every individual, is of course crucial in this context, and just as a basic element, but very important to keep in mind at all stages of the investigation, is that you need to respect privacy. We just not mean that privacy is an absolute right. Often individuals involved in investigations, they use privacy in order to try to protect themselves against discovery, against investigation actions, and to say, well, nothing is possible. You may not do this or that because I'm protected by privacy. This is not the case. You can, let's say, intrude in the privacy. You can lift the protection given by privacy under three basic conditions. And that's something you need to keep in mind about privacy. It is these three conditions. You always, as an investigator or a company or an employer, you need to have a legitimate goal. And it can be of different kind, but typically the goals are protecting your economic business, your economic interests, or avoiding unacceptable behavior by any of your workers or contractors, or other to safeguard security and safety within the company. So these are legitimate goals. And in order to achieve the goal, you can intrude in someone's privacy if this intrusion is done in a proportionate way. And that's an important element, the proportionality of your actions in light of the goal that you are trying to achieve. And that's always a balancing exercise. And we will come back to that when we discuss monitoring of mailbox and hidden camera surveillance. But you should always do it in a way which is necessary to achieve the goal. And if you have means to try to achieve that goal, which are less intrusive into privacy, then you should go for that less intrusive option. And then the third condition is transparency, meaning that the individuals who can be the subject of the investigation should know on beforehand which kind of actions, tools can be used by the company, under which conditions, what will be done with the outcome, etc. So based on an informed consent, and which basically boils down to having a clear policy within the company, which outlines the boundaries of your potential actions. And that will probably also be already one of the conclusions of the day, but I also at the beginning, I like to underscore that having policies, having rules and procedures in place in the company, that will be one of the key success factors for your investigation process. Of course, always nowadays, GDPR comes around the corner, also in the context of investigation. GDPR will play a role when, in the context of the investigation, when you would collect data, process data, then of course GDPR rules will also apply. We will not go into much detail about that because that's a session in itself, but keep that in mind. That's also an element which is important as a general legal context of the investigation. And then lastly, national criminal and civil law provisions can also play a role, also criminal provisions, in the context of a purely private internal investigation. And in general, what we always say to our clients when they do an investigation, we say, well, the benchmark, the guideline should be to have an investigation which is reasonable in all circumstances, which means that the investigation should, at all stages of the process, be fair, careful, balanced, and thorough. And these four elements, they summarize a little bit how we look at the investigation process. And the next couple of minutes during the presentation, we will try to detail more for you how to achieve that fairness, careful, balanced, and thorough approach in the investigation. If you then go to the next slide, then we get our first key question. When do you start an investigation, an internal investigation? And the answer looks very straightforward. As soon as you have sufficient elements or indications which point into the direction of a serious misbehavior, a wrongdoing, fraud, but fraud is a very loaded term, of course, but if there are sufficient indications of a serious misbehavior within the company, then you could start, and then you typically would start an internal investigation. And then comes, of course, the question, how are you, when or how are you informed about such serious misbehavior? And I always say there are two ways of information. That is the informal channel, and that is the formal channel. The formal channel, we will take some time to go into that detail, because there has been some new legislative development. That's the whistleblowing hotline and the whistleblowing channels, which you can have formalized within the company. But let's not forget that informal channels are equally important, and often important misbehavior, important fraud comes up by the persons who are close to the facts within the company, and who in an informal way notify you of something that they have seen or have experienced. And they can be people from HR internally, from audit, from controlling, but also external service providers, customers, everybody. So always, the recommendation here is always keep your eyes and ears open for what happens within the company. Do not only stare to the mailbox of your whistleblowing hotline and wait for a formal notification, but be aware that within the company, a lot of information is often circulating, and try to pick up that information. And in order to get that information above the waterline, it is important to have what we call a speak up culture. To have a culture within the company where people are not afraid to share their ideas, their concerns with you, to report things that they have discovered or that they have seen. So if there is a culture in which you stimulate it, in which you incentivize people coming up with things they have seen in the company, I think that's an important, let's say, a precondition to get fraud within the company or wrongdoing on the surface. But then going to the more formalized channel, which is the whistleblowing hotline. Currently, at least in Belgium and in many of the European countries, there is no strict statutory framework for whistleblowing hotlines. There are some exceptions in Belgium. We have the public sector, where we have at federal and at regional level a kind of a public hotline for civil servants. There are some regulated industries in which for some topics whistleblowing hotlines are mandatory. But in general, if you have a hotline at this moment already in place in the private sector, it is simply based on self-regulation and on the company deeming it appropriate and useful to have a hotline. This will change. Because, and you probably already heard of the European Directive 2019/1937, which is the directive on the protection of persons reporting breaches of EU law. And this directive has as or aims at enhancing the protection of whistleblowers by introducing common minimum standards, let's to say, which will apply to whistleblowing or to certain whistleblowing hotlines. So this directive will have as a result, and I will go into more detail in a minute, but will have as a result that companies for certain areas of practice will need to have, will must have a whistleblowing hotline. And this hotline must comply with a number of standards. Some of the standards or the requirements are that there should be a clear and sufficient protection against retaliation, because that's, of course, the hurdle which may prevent people from reporting breaches. should provide for reversal of burden of proof, come back to that later on, damage claims, and so on. And the deadline for the member states to implement the directive is the 17th of December of this year. So that means that normally all member states are supposed to have implemented this directive within, let's say, 2 months' time, which is pretty short. And if you go to the next slide, you will see that most of countries still have some work to do. The countries in red and Belgium, you will see the small spot of Belgium is also in red. These are the countries which did not yet have made any progress in implementing the directive. And that's, let's say, the major part of relevant countries. Only a few countries are in green, so they have already a system in place, a legal system, which complies to the minimum requirements of the directive. But most of the countries, they are not yet on schedule to have something implemented by the end of this year. You see on the slide also an interesting reference to a whistleblower blog where you can follow up the current developments in different countries. I think that Sweden, I read that they last week even, they adopted a new law on implementing some whistleblowing protection. There some progress has been made also in the meantime. Next slide, please. The whistleblowing, and I'll zoom in to it for a few minutes because it's so new and it might change the way in which we structure the reporting of fraud within our companies. Central provisions. First of all, the scope. In what situations will the directive apply, and will a whistleblowing hotline be mandatory? The directive applies to reporting persons working in both private and public sector who acquired information on breaches in a work-related context. So there are a number of four different important elements in that definition. Reporting persons, both public and private sector, they have acquired some information about breaches in the company, and this in a work-related context. The directive will detail that further on. I refer you to the text of the directive there. But the personal scope, who can be a reporting person, is very broad. Everybody active in that famous work-related context. Of course, employees, but also people working on a self-employed basis, contractors, trainees and volunteers, but also shareholders of a company, members of senior management, and any person working under the direction, supervision, and control of a contractor and supplier comes also under the scope of the directive. So anyone who is in one or the other way active in the work-related environment can and will be allowed to report breaches through the whistleblowing system. What is the scope, the material scope? What kind of breaches can be reported? Well, that's limited, so to say, to breaches of union law. And what is union law? That's the law of the European Union. If you go to the directive, you will see in one of the first articles of the directive a full list of legislation, European legislation, which is covered and for which a whistleblowing hotline must be established. And that includes public procurement, transport safety, public health, consumer protection, internal market, you name it. It's a long list. It's pretty extensive. But the directive explicitly mentions that member states may extend this protection under national law. So they can even, there is a lot of flexibility, they can go beyond European law. And I understood from a colleague from Germany that they have already a draft bill, I think, not yet adopted, but a draft bill in which the scope of the whistleblowing procedure is broadened beyond European Union law. And the reason for that, one of the main arguments is that for a whistleblower, it's very difficult to make a distinction between, is this now something which relates to the Union law, or is it someone else, something else? And to avoid that, the whistleblower has to make that distinction. The scope in most, or it is expected that for most countries, they will opt for a broader scope than purely only Union law. But that's to be seen, of course. We will see in the coming months what the effective legislations will bring to us and to what extent they will be different one from the other. Let's move to the next slide, please. The central idea is that there is an obligation to establish an internal reporting channel for legal entities with 50 or more workers. And so for the pretty small companies with less than 50 employees, they will not be obliged to establish the reporting channels. It only applies if you have 50 or more workers. And the basic idea is that you have a system of internal and external reporting. So if the whistleblower finds out that something's going wrong, that there's a breach of relevant regulations which come under the scope of the whistleblowing process, he reports that through the internal or external reporting line. An internal reporting line is internally within the company. That's something that you establish yourself as a company, an internal process that you have. The external reporting is reporting with an external competent authority. Can be a regulator in a regulated industry, for instance. That's typically an example there. But both reporting mechanisms should be in place to make sure that a whistleblower has a channel to which he can report his the breach that he has been witnessed. The public disclosure, that's, let's say, the worst case scenario, that's the option of last resort. That is that a whistleblower, if he is not successful through the internal or internal reporting lines, because there is no internal reporting line, or his report has not been addressed properly, or has been rejected, and things like that, he can, under certain conditions, go public and do a public disclosure, like going to the press. So that's the third option, which can only be applied by a whistleblower if he went first through internal and external reporting channels. But here you see immediately the big danger of reporting lines and where the risk for the company lies. It's not only and not always a purely financial risk, but a reputational risk. That's really the risk that you as a company run. That is that finally someone who does not have an internal way of reporting what he wants to report goes public and discloses it to the press with all publicity, negative publicity, that you absolutely want to try to avoid. So that's the reason often, and after the implementation of the directive will be the reason to have a good internal, external reporting line. In your case, the company internal reporting lines in place. The internal reporting line can be done by your company yourself. You can also outsource it to an external provider. And there are currently already a number of providers, you probably know them, who are on the market to try to sell their business. I've got last week also a presentation of one of the digital platforms they are offering for a price. It was about, I think, 2,000 or 3,000 euro a year. You have a kind of digital system with what they say sufficiently guarantees and safeguards, compliant with the EU directive, where people can in an electronic way do their reporting, and there is then an automatic follow-up and dispatch to to the relevant persons of that report that has been submitted. There is also
maybe
a way...
Jan, maybe sorry for interrupting you. I just got a question via the direct question. In the context of a multinational group, sometimes we are struggling with the fact that is it okay to have a central whistleblowing procedure at the group level, or do we need to have an outline for each and every country, or translation voiceover can make the job? What are exactly the stuff that we need to put in place to this regard, Jan?
Yeah, well, from a practical perspective, multinational companies would like to centralize it at, let's say, headquarter level, because then you have only one point of information stream that you can easily control. But the directive refers to the legal entities. And so the whistleblowing, the obligation to set up a whistleblowing procedure is at legal entity level. So you must make sure that every legal entity has a kind of access to its specific, let's say, internal channel. There are ways to share resources, especially for entities with 50 to 250 workers, but you must make sure that every entity has its own channel, because that's what the scope is of the directive, is legal entity level. And if you centralize, anyway, if you do it centralized or decentralized, the challenges often remain the same. For instance, you mentioned having different languages. I mean, in Belgium, we all know that we have at least three official languages. You also want to offer it in English. And most of the hotlines that I've seen provide many languages in a way that everybody who wants to report something can do it in his own native language. That's also often the idea. To do it. Next slide, please. In the past, in case law, especially from the Court of Justice, it was always stated that in whistleblower cases, that a whistleblower had first to go to an internal channel before going to an external channel, to a relevant competent authority. This has changed now with the directive. There is no priority anymore of the internal channel over the external channel. The directive only states that member states should try to encourage internal reporting before going external. But there is no priority anymore as it was in the past in some of the case law of the Court of Justice. And then the directive provides for a good procedure. And I think this is a good practice, the best practice. If, even when you are not under the scope of the directive, if you want to implement a whistleblowing hotline, you find in the directive a pretty good benchmark of what a well-functioning whistleblowing line could look like. And the procedure is that you need to ensure confidentiality of identity at all stages of the process. And that's further detailed in the directive and should also be regulated further on in the implementing legislation. There should be an acknowledgement of receipt within a short timing, in principle within 7 days. There must be a diligent follow-up of the report by an impartial person who is designated for that job and who then probably also signs a confidentiality clause or an NDA to make sure that he treats all the information that he receives through the hotline in a very confidential manner. The treatment of the report should be done within a reasonable time frame, and the directive gives there a maximum deadline of 3 months from the acknowledgement of the report. And the company should provide clear and easily accessible information on the hotline, how it works, what is the process, what is done with information, and so on. So that anybody who wants to blow the whistle on beforehand knows where to go to and what he or she can expect. A discussion with hotlines we often have is, do we accept anonymous reporting, or do we always ask for someone to identify himself? And the directive does not exclude anonymous reporting, but leaves it over to the national law to provide whether or not they accept it under which conditions, and if applicable, what the specific rules then will be in case of anonymous reporting. My personal experience is, it has been a lot of discussion over the past years, anonymous yes or no. It is a bit overrated as a topic, I think, because anonymous reports are often not so useful. Someone who remains anonymous is, in my experience, often not giving a lot of supporting documentation. It's always often not very clear, vague. So what I get from feedback from companies operating whistleblowing hotlines where anonymous reporting is allowed, that is that often this is maybe a first step, but then is quickly afterwards the reporter will identify himself and do an unnamed report. There must be certain safeguards for the process of under GDPR, of course. The data should be processed in line with GDPR. Report should be kept and so on. That all will be regulated in more detail once we have the member states legislation. Next slide, please. And then my last slide on the whistleblowing hotlines is the most important one is the protection of the reporting person, because that's what the system of whistleblowing hotlines provides for and aims for. That is to protect reporting persons, to make sure that they are willing to report, that they are not afraid for retaliation. And so there is a prohibition of retaliation, which means that any form of retaliation because of the fact that someone has reported a breach is prohibited. And retaliation can take any form, like dismissal, layoff, demotion, refusal of a promotion, change in employment conditions, a bonus which is reduced, whatever, or a bonus refusal, whatever action that could be taken by the company to the detriment of the person reporting comes under that prohibition. And if a person, a reporting person, suffers a negative treatment because of, or believes that he is negatively treated because of his reporting, there will be a shift of the burden of proof. The company will then have to prove that the action taken or the detrimental measure that it has taken with regard to the reporting person was based on duly justified grounds. So the burden of proof there lies with the company, which is a bit similar to discrimination cases, where there's also a reversal of the burden of proof. So there's a presumption that there is retaliation, and it's up to the company to prove the contrary. Further remedies, penalties, and damages must be provided by national law, but should be effective and sufficient. And also the person concerned, that's the one who is named in the report as the one to whom the breach is can be attributed. Also for him, there are, or her, there are the system or the mechanism should provide for some protection, including the presumption, which is of innocence, which speaks for itself, and the guarantee of his rights of defense, like the right to be heard, access to his file, often a discussion, an investigation, do we get access to the file, to the initial report, to assess what the initial allegation was. Well, that access is guaranteed under the directive, and the protection of the identity of the person concerned for as long as the investigation is ongoing. Next slide, please. Yeah, being conscious of time, I'll quickly go to this slide. It's a bit of the conclusion. Will this change a lot? To be honest, I think so. I think that this directive will raise awareness with companies that they need to do so, even when, let's imagine Belgian law, we have not yet seen any text, they are not yet circulating, but let's imagine that Belgium would opt for a very restrictive approach. I can't imagine, but could be possible to limit it only to a breach of union law. I can imagine that many companies will take this directive as a kind of a wake-up call to see, well, our internal policies, are they still up to speed? Are they okay? Or do we have to redesign them a bit in line with the guarantees and procedures and mechanisms of the directive? The speak-up culture is a very important point of attention in the context of whistleblowing and of getting elements, facts, potential indication of fraud on the table, and should be part of your internal policy. I think we discussed already the issue of central versus decentralized reporting, especially for groups headquartered outside Europe. This might be a challenge. Provide also for a selection mechanism on credible notifications and a mechanism to reject minor reports of reports which are not accurate or not credible. The language issue is in practice always a topic. I've already touched on that a minute ago. Globally spoken, this whistleblowing hotline notification process, however you want to call it, should be included in your company's code of business conduct, or should be part of a more global approach on how you look at business conduct of your workers and everybody in the company. And to quote a colleague of mine a few weeks ago, he said, compliance is going to be the next big thing, and in my view, is already a big thing, and companies which will get ready for the protection of whistleblowers first will have the competitive edge. And that's also what I'm convinced of. This is a challenge maybe to implement it, but it's also an opportunity to position your company as a true company which attaches to values and who wants to make sure that they have a safe and non-fraudulent environment. And if you move to the next slide, I think I can pass on to Yves for the next question, I think, Bruno, if that's correct.
Indeed, yeah. Challenge for Yves, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Jan, thank you, Bruno. Also for me, hello, good morning, good day. How to get the ball rolling? Now, the whistle has been blown, as we have seen, and before going and that the train leaves the station, it's important to make a few considerations on the plan, your action plan for your investigation, the team, and who will be involved. It's a short slide, but a very important slide, because it will determine the next steps of the investigation. So first of all, obviously, internal investigation, fraud investigation, the scope is very large. But it's important that once the scope and the issue has been identified in the whistleblowing channels and it is serious, etc., that once indeed determines who is involved. And if we have done that, that we're going to see, okay, first thing first, secure and gather evidence, because basically the investigation is about gathering evidence and to check whether certain rumors or notifications are correct, yes or no, to then take action. So securing and gathering evidence is of a great importance, and it's also sometimes company, let's say, nation dependent on how to do it, whether you have to go to court to take certain actions and the like, especially, and we see that later on today, obviously, IT investigation. So that's basically the next step. You must determine what disciplines, what kind of knowledge I need to effectively conduct my investigation. So basically setting up the team. I put on the slide IT, obviously, if it's more difficult outside IT council, and forensic accounting. Those two are mostly part of the team, but also outside communication, how we will communicate with outside world, when we will communicate, what if there is a leak and the press rings the CEO, what to say, who will say it. So there also, from the outset, I believe it's important to think about it and to see how you will react to questions asked from outside the team. A third point, which is corporate governance-wise very important, reporting lines. Who will call the shots for the company? And who will be, let's say, advised with the progress of the report, and who will take the decisions? That's important. We will see that later on in the last part. That best thing is that it's not the person who is, for example, in the case of an employee issue, responsible or has the authority to dismiss that employee. Because we know in Belgium, for example, there is a 3-day rules. Once you know the facts that leads to a serious breach, then you have to act within 3 days. And if that person is reported of interim reports, etc., it could be argued that he was aware at the time of that information and not at the time, for example, of the complete report that we are making. So reporting lines are quite important. They can change over time because a person who is a team might become suspicious and might become involved. So an important point. Lastly, when to involve outside counsel. As outside counsel, I would say before and rather now than later. But it's important to consider two, three things. The first thing is that an outside counsel acts for the company. He does not act for CFO, HR manager, and the like. So in view of the scope and the finality of the report, the use you will make with the report, it is important to know that the legal privilege goes to the company and that the outside counsel will give advice, opinions to the company and not to individual persons within the organization. And second point, obviously, legal privilege. Legal privilege secrecy depends on state, on nation, on nation. But that's also crucial. That's also crucial in view of, let's say, the use you will take from the report. Is it internally? Is it indeed, please check from a legal point of view whether we are compliant, yes or no? If that's the case, legal privilege is quite important. On the other hand, in some cases, legal privilege can be an obstacle to move forward. No, also legal privilege, we can write books about it. It is not 100% guaranteed. There is always somebody with a gun who says, I want to see the report and I can because I have those investigating powers. I must say in the civil law countries, the Code Napoleon countries, the professional secrecy of an outside counsel of a lawyer is quite strong and because it's also sanctioned in the criminal law. And last but not least, I think an outside counsel, because of that secrecy obligation, he can oversee the actions and he can indeed advise on the different aspects of the case, when to terminate the relationship with the employee, with the contractor, etc. What is about recovery, preparation for recovery? What about the remedies? What about should we take some action from a legal point of view, which might be delicate for directors' liability and the like. So there, I think legal counsel, legal outside counsel can be very useful. Also minding the time, I think, Jan, I go over to you to see, okay, what can we do and give a little bit of flavor of the action investigative measures that can be taken before we can go to the next steps.
Yes, thank you, Yves. Sorry, I still have to unmute myself. Thank you, Yves. Indeed, when the investigation starts, you need to think of what are the actions that I will take to discover the facts. Of course, a company, a private company, does not have the power that the public authorities have. You cannot arrest someone, of course. You cannot do a house search as such under the conditions that an investigating judge or the public prosecutor could do. So if you limit the investigation to your own company and you do it yourself, then the four mostly used tools are mentioned on my slide, which is monitoring of a mailbox, potentially use of hidden cameras, search of open sources, and interviews. And I will for a minute zoom in to them, because here comes always the discussion about privacy and to what extent are we allowed to monitor like mailboxes on the other communication. I will not go into the specific legislation in Belgium, but it's all based on privacy, and there is a very important ruling of the European Court of Human Rights of September 2017 of the Grand Chamber in the so-called Barbulescu case. And that was a case where the company had a policy saying that you can only use the company's tools, internet, laptop, and so on, for professional use only. So private use was not allowed. And the employer discovered that nevertheless, Mr. Barbulescu had sent some Yahoo messages using his professional laptop and using the internet during working time. And it was dismissed. And then was the question, the evidence based on this is mailbox and the internet registrations of what he did during his working time, are they obtained in line with privacy rights, yes or no? And the conclusion in this case was no, there was a violation of privacy, so the evidence was not acceptable under privacy law. And the court looked to a number of criteria, and you will see afterwards that in case law after 2017, the same or similar criteria will always be used to check whether your discovery process was in line with privacy. And one of the elements is, has there been a prior notification of the fact that there could be possibly a monitoring of a mailbox in certain circumstances, in case of suspicion of fraud, for instance? This comes back again to the informed consent, which I mentioned in the beginning, and to having a clear policy where the employees know that this kind of monitoring of the mailbox is in the future possible under certain circumstances. What was the extent of the monitoring? What was the degree of intrusion in the private life of Mr. Barbulescu? Is there only the control over or the monitoring of the flow of the communication? Or does the employer, the company go further than that, beyond that? And is there also a monitoring of the content of messages, which of course is more intrusive in the private life, and where of course the criteria and the requirements are even stronger than if you are limiting your monitoring to the flow of communication, what communication is sent at what date and what time, and not checking the content of a message. Does the company have legitimate reasons to justify the monitoring? Were there less intrusive monitoring systems possible, yes or no? If so, why didn't they apply them? And what was the use made of results of the monitoring? And based on those elements, in the Barbulescu case, for instance, there was no notification at all prior done by the company, for instance. So there the court came to the conclusion that the monitoring of the mailbox was in violation of privacy. In Belgium, not going to the detail of the Belgian legislation, there we have a collective labor agreement number 81, which applies, which is more or less a kind of translation of the European principles of Article 8 of the European Convention. But there is an opinion of the Belgian Privacy Authority, which dates from 2012, so before the Barbulescu case. But there, the privacy authority made a distinction between the situation. First situation is where the company allows private use of the tools of the company. And there is a double use, professional use and private use. And in that case, the privacy authority said, well, you have to provide in your policy that the employee needs to label explicitly the messages which are private and allow them to store these messages in a private zone, a private space of the internet or of the system that is made available for them. If that's the case, then your investigation, you can investigate the professional emails, but you will not be allowed to investigate the emails which are or the communication which is labeled as explicitly labeled as private. If you have a second situation, second option, and that's the option which I see now nowadays mostly applied in Belgian companies, is the professional use only policy, where you say, well, our tools can only be used for professional purpose. You may not use for private reasons your the internet or the mailbox. Then you broaden the scope of the investigation. The potential of your investigation is broader because all communication is deemed to be professional, which does not mean, referring to the Barbulescu case, that there is no reasonable expectation of privacy at all, even when you have a professional use only policy. Even then, employees can expect from time to time to have to be protected by privacy and have a reasonable expectation that for certain communication there is a privacy protection. So there is still the check to be done always. Is our investigation of a mailbox, the screening, is that in line with proportionality? And the guideline there is try to avoid checking the content of the messages. Limit yourself to the flow of communication. And if you go to the content of message, do it in a limited way where you use, for instance, search words, which are clearly linked to the fraud that you are investigating and not going beyond that. And secondly, respect transparency. Have the informed consent of the employees by having an email policy, an IT policy in place. The first question that we always ask when starting an investigation, we do not do the investigation ourselves, but when advising on an investigation, is please give us the IT policy, because that will for us give us the playground of where we can, how far the investigators can go in screening the mailbox. And much of many information in the context of the investigation comes up through the screening of a mailbox in practice. Second topic or second tool is the video surveillance. There is a question, may we use hidden cameras at the workplace to film and monitor behavior of employees? I will only refer to the case of the European Court of Human Rights of October 2019. Lopez case, where it has been decided, and I will not discuss the entire case, of course, it will take too much time, but this was the recording. There was a suspicion of theft in a market, supermarket, and there was the owner had installed a number of cameras to monitor the behavior of a few of his cashiers. And at the end of the day, they were able to film the theft going on. There, the court decided that this was allowed, even when it was a hidden camera. So the employees, the staff was not aware of the camera filming them, but it was accepted because it was only for a temporary period. There had been a notification in the past that such a camera could be used in case of suspicion of fraud. And given the circumstances, the market, supermarket, is a publicly accessible place, so there is a lower expectation of privacy there. So you see, it's a nuanced debate, if I may say so, but there is often more possible than you sometimes think. Most people say hidden cameras, it's not allowed, let's not do that. If you play it, if you do it in the right way, you can justify it, and in the right context with the right policy in place, this is absolutely possible and doable. Next slide, please. That's an open door, so I'll simply mention that there is some case law in Belgium which says that use of open sources, everything that you post on internet, in social media, can be used against you. That's a rule to keep in mind. So don't hesitate if you're investigating something to use any information that is publicly available. But that's maybe not very new to the most of you. And then lastly, interviews, conducting an interview. That's also an important element in the context of an investigation. You interview colleagues, customers, employees, staff, contractors, whoever. There is no specific legislation or rule governing an interview in the context of an employment relationship. You need to refer yourself there to some good or best practices. You might know that in the context of a criminal investigation, if there is an interview done by the public prosecutor's office, that there is for someone who is for a suspect, there is a kind of protection based on the Saldus legislation, which is also European case law. So it applies to most of the European countries. And there, the suspect in the context of interview has certain rights, and it needs to be informed of these rights before the interview takes place. And these rights, I will not go into the full detail. You can find them in Article 47 bis of the Belgian Code on Criminal Proceedings. But it's like rights like they have to tell the person who is interviewed, give him a summary of the facts and the context in which the interview takes place, that he can be assisted by legal counsel, that his words will be recorded in the minutes of the interview in the way that he pronounced and used them and not otherwise. He has the right to check, review and change if he considers that what is in the minutes of the meeting is not in line with the words that he has spoken, and so on and so forth. So there are a number of elements, and we always advise investigators, if they do interviews, do it in line with this Saldus procedure and the Saldus rights, which are clearly defined in Belgian law. And you can find that's, I think, very useful for people who are in practice investigating, on the website of the Belgian Public Prosecutor, a two-pager document which they use when they start with an interview. And you find it back in all possible languages, English, Polish, Danish, Dutch, French, whatever. So there you can find it back. It's very useful to keep that in your pocket when you have an interview and to start, like you would be someone from police, starting with the interview by reading someone's rights before kicking off. If you record the interview, and recording is done more and more, I see in practice, ask for the consent, get it in writing from the person that you interview, and give him, of course, afterwards a free copy of the recording, and give him the right to review and to change if necessary. Do you allow the assistance of a counsel at the interview? My answer, I had a longer story prepared, but it would be yes, I would do that to make sure that the interview will not be challenged afterwards in litigation as being not objective, and that he could not defend himself correctly. So let's now move on to Yves again.
Yeah, I think we will move to the how to deal with the outcome of the investigation in the interest of time. I know that the subject is quite interesting, so we went a bit more over time, but the session is recorded, so people can go back to that. But Yves, the floor is yours on, I will say, on how to deal with the outcome of the investigation, especially the famous report that will come out of the investigation.
Thank you, Bruno, and I will give indeed some key points before lunch will be getting cold. Perhaps the previous slide, Eva, on we talked about indeed the rules on the investigatory measures. Luckily, I would say, because those rules can be indeed sometimes blurry, unclear, and interpreted afterwards, there is a kind of a safety net, if I may call it, in Belgium, and I understand it, there is the same or similar rules across the continent, at least I've read about Germany, France, Italy, as a safety net where illegally gathered evidence, can still be used and is not excluded from legal proceedings. In Belgium, it started in 2003 with the anti-Gone case law, where it was in the framework of a police actions called anti-Gone. That's why it is the anti-Gone case law. Also happens to be in Antwerp, the city of anti-Gone. But there it was ruled by the Supreme Court of Belgium that the exclusion can only be done if, one, there is a violation of formalities sanctioned with nullity by law, violation that impacts the credibility or the reliability of the evidence itself, and thirdly, that the use of that illegally obtained evidence does not violate the right of fair trial. This case law was confirmed by the European Court in Lee Davies case law of 2009, but however, the origin and the scope of application is criminal law procedure. So we have been in dubio since 2003 on whether the same escape route safety net applies to non-criminal law matters. First, good news, 14th of June 2021, so for a lawyer it was yesterday, the Belgian Supreme Court accepted the anti-Gone criteria in a civil law case. It's about commercial contract on the sale of a car where on the price, and it was a, let's say, a secretly taped telephone conversation that was used, and there the court says, okay, it meets the criteria, I will use it. The question is, there's a lot of debate in tax law. It's not yet fully accepted. I understand in labor law, there is some case law going against it, but it's generally, I think, indeed accepted. But the Supreme Court of 2021, of 14 June, is quite important to indeed also implement that case law into other, let's say, areas of sport. In order to be to secure that you can, let's say, apply that case law, it's good that you make in your report itself a note when you believe that there might be a violation or could be a violation, and you're going to motivate basically those criteria to say, okay, I have done this, but there was no other way to do it, and we will keep it in the report for this this reason, because also, as we know, credibility, reliability, in many cases, it's more reliable when you obtain it illegally than legally, because you do not have to go to a procedure, and the reliability is let's say, safeguarded. Also, right of fair trial, a great concept, I would say, legal paradise. So there, it's a hurdle easy to take. So notwithstanding the, let's say, the rules that Jan set out, there is a safety net in Belgium that can help us. Eva, let's go to the next slide. What are we going to do with the report? How to deal with the outcome of the investigation? A few points on that. I will not take more than 5 minutes to conclude. The report should secure objectivity. Objectivity, so it should include all the annexes from the investigator. The report is evidence. So evidence means supporting documents. Should there be a contradiction? Question mark. Yes, in the ideal world, yes, in some circumstances, you will not be able to do that contradiction because the purpose of your investigation will become difficult. So mostly you do it at the end of the report, prior to, dare I say it, the disciplinary hearing, or prior to terminating relationships. When I go to, and I miss one bullet point, do you need a full report before taking actions? Is to be seen. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. But for example, if you make a report on fraud, the elements of fraud are determined, but you are still working on the damages. You can imagine that you can take, I don't take a full report, I take an interim report to take already actions, because the other steps like recovery will not be, let's say, adversely affected by the interim report. Termination relationships, I said it before, you have the 3 day in Belgium, the 3 day period to terminate an employment contract for serious cause. You have commercial agency agreements where you have the same mechanism, but there is a 7 day period. And sometimes, indeed, the contract itself can stipulate some serious breaches. I've seen contracts where it is that a serious breach is, or a reason for termination for cause is the conviction for fraud, for example. Then you have to wait that you have a conviction, and it will be very difficult to terminate based on an internal report, for example. So there you have to double check the contracts and local law to see when you will use a report and to whom you will report it. For the 3-day period, for example, it is accepted that you do an investigation following the rumors, and that you do not act on rumors, that you do a full investigation, but has to be done with due diligence. Secondly, that you confront the party before taking a disciplinary sanction or a termination for cause. And indeed, the rule, the 3-day rule, especially labor law, but also the 7-day rule, that is only as from the time that the person who has the authority to take action has been, let's say, informed. A final point, which is quite interesting, is we see sometimes that settlements are made with wrongdoers, with victims, of hashtag MeToo, etc., and that parties, companies would like to include an NDA, a non-disclosure obligation, a secrecy obligation. The question is that wise to do? Is that wise to do? Two points to point out. One, the whistleblowing directive that Jan talked about provides explicitly that there will be no breach of such an undertaking, contractual undertaking, if indeed there are reasonable grounds for the person who has, let's say, committed to the non-disclosure, if there are reasonable grounds that he believes that for the purposes of, let's say, revealing and the breach, he has to go public. So the NDA can be set aside by, let's say, the directive and by probably national legislation, so your NDA will not be watertight. And secondly, do you really want to have the perception in the market that you try to cover up, let's say, some internal business from the outside world? So think about the opportunity and the let's say, whether it is useful and wise to have an NDA in your settlement agreement, because we see it as a boilerplate in many settlement agreements, but think about that. Next slide, please, Eva. Another point is preparing for recovery. It's important as soon as possible and whilst the investigation goes on to trace and secure assets. The first thing is identify the assets and identify the debtors. With public searches, etc., you can go and see, okay, there was be fraud, who is involved, what are the management companies and other companies attached. Secondly, check the conditions and possibilities for securing assets in a different countries affected. What we can do to freeze an account, what assets we can block, and can I appoint a custodian, and what are the conditions? Because those conditions perhaps take some time to be fulfilled, and then you can work towards that alongside with the investigation of the facts. So be there fully informed in order to have that in parallel. Because sometimes we get a report and they say, okay, Eve, go and recover, but then, okay, you make the consideration, we are a little bit late, we will not find a lot of assets, or we will lose time, for example, to have some certificates from the mortgage register, information from the land register, etc., etc. A final point I want to share with you, a question that comes up is, yeah, do we have to go criminal? Do we have to go to the public prosecutor's office? Do we have to file a criminal complaint? First, check the different types of complaints you have in your country. In Belgium, you have the simple complaint, which implies that you just go to the public prosecutor's office without the constitution of civil party, as we call it. So with a simple complaint, you will not have the criminalité en civil en état, that's for once. And two, without the constitution of civil party, the investigation magistrate is not triggered, is not activated. And only the investigating magistrate will have to conduct a criminal investigation. The public prosecutor does not have to do it. So if you want to be certain that the facts are taken seriously and are being investigated, you should file a complaint with constitution of civil party, but you have to check that in each country. Do you have a choice? Because if you say, okay, we will do it yes or no, the answer is yes, you have a choice, unless you are a public servant. And for example, unless a judge is a public servant, so he can contact the public prosecutor's office in the framework of a civil proceedings. If the civil servant is confronted with facts that might be qualified as a breach of criminal law, then he has the obligation, the personal obligation, to report that to the public prosecutor's office. So even if you choose to keep it internal and not to go to the criminal road, it might be that your choice is been disregarded, so to speak, by the judge if you keep it civil. And then the final slide for the part before the small wrapper, Eva, is okay, how and when do we go in criminal and file a complaint? It's the I spoke with Jan and he had the wording, it's a delicate exercise depending on the facts and on the case. Indeed, you will have to balance a lot of interests and considerations. I put the six of them on the slide. Investigation powers, obviously, Jan told about it. Obviously, the public prosecutor can do more than we can do. Watch out, perhaps your civil action is blocked, the criminalité en civil en état. Be aware you lose control of the scope and timing of the investigation. Timing, we know it depends on availability and the eagerness of the public prosecutor and the investigating magistrates, but also about the scope. So it might be, let's say, an oil spill that goes beyond the boundaries that you had imagined at the start of the investigation. So the scope is also something important. Impact on the company. I filed a year ago in a certain matter a criminal complaint with the Constitutional Civil Party. The first thing they have done is a search within the offices of my clients, so the victim basically, which was quite unexpected, unexpected for the clients. So there can be unexpected things and an intrusion of your company dealing. Asset tracing and securing, obviously, they can block an account on the British Virgin Islands. For me, it's much more difficult to do it as a civil law lawyer, to go and block accounts around the world or to trace some money. And then reputational risk management. As I said before, your team should be somebody appointed as being the communication, let's say, point of contact. Yes, criminal investigation is secret, but we know all that leaks from that site are not, let's say, seldom. So I think we go to the takeaways, Bruno, bearing in mind the time as well. I will go very quickly through them. The takeaways we have for today is, okay, set up your whistleblowing tools and stimulate speak up culture. The story of the directive, we know it. Implement at all stages the fair, balanced, thorough and careful principles in your investigation, all decisions you make. Determine timely the scope and the team, quite important, difficult to remedy. Have policy in place to avoid time and efficiency loss, because policies makes things very easier, not very easier, but easier. It will save you some time and money and efficiency. Include in policies also outside employment relations. What do I mean with that is that we have a lot of policies that apply to the employees, but do those also apply to your independent contractors, third-party contractors, in which that comes into your working environment? And totally, and finally, respect local requirements on timing of the disciplinary actions. Belgian law, the 3-day, commercial agencies, 7-day. So do that check on beforehand, so you have your plan ready and your red flags within the timeline.
And it's true that I will add also an additional one, that because it's true that we work for a European-based company, but sometimes we also work for companies that are headquartered outside of the European Union, including in the US. And sometimes we also have, we in-house counsel, we have to mitigate, I will say, and manage the expectation of our US colleagues when they are not aware of those a lot of those local requirements that we have to follow in order to run, I will say, a bulletproof investigation. Sometimes they would like to go a bit quicker, and sometimes you have also to balance the fact if you go quicker, then being compliant will have a higher cost, and you may have to pay indemnity to the fraudulent employees because you want to have him out. So we have to do a bit of this messenger between two legal culture regarding internal investigation, what happened, I would say, within the European countries and also outside of the European countries. So that's this is where we are of importance as in-house counsel working in Europe, but also in connection with other regions of the world. So thank you, Yves and Jan, for this very interesting conversation. I saw that there was a few questions popping up on the chat, but we'll take them. We will take them online. And with that, I wish, sorry for being, we have been late, but I guess the topic was really justifying that. And we'll please also go and check the ACC Europe website, where you can see some additional opportunity to train yourself on a lot of current topic. And there is always a lot of stuff. And now with the digitalization, you can access even more training than just traveling to the location. And with that, I wish you happy afternoon, good afternoon, and I wish you to see you soon on another webinar that we will be hosting with Lydion and some other partners. Have a nice afternoon. Thank you one more time, Yves and Jan, and goodbye to everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Bruno. Bye, everybody.